It shouldn't come as a surprise, but it is shocking to realize that everything in the pagan world depended on exploiting their most sacred, but also their most plentiful natural resource, wood.
Whilst the tree was the symbol that shaped their spiritual life, necessity required that they build their world of timber. They had to exploit the forests, but nature did not give so freely. There was a price to pay, and a heavy price at that.
Our pagan ancestors would sometimes pay with their lives. 290 BC, Denmark. A pagan man is beaten, stripped naked, his throat slit, and his body thrown into a watery pit to rot. Except he didn't rot. He became a bog body. His flesh and hair, even his fingerprints, preserved in the unique environment of a Danish bog. Is this incriminating evidence of a vicious and brutal society? The dark side of our pagan ancestry. Analysis of his fingerprints has shown that Graubler man has a direct genetic link with 80% of modern Danes. So we can't just dismiss him as belonging to another world, another culture, having nothing to do with us. On the contrary, I believe Graubler man offers us a vital clue which helps us to understand our ancestors' relationship with nature and our own.
Yeah, I think it's fantastic that he's so well preserved and he belongs to a very...
Pauline Assing led the team that investigated this pagan murder mystery.
So, Pauline, in Denmark, you're known, jokingly, as Graubler man's wife because you know so much about him. So could you tell me a bit about him?
Now we know more about what happened the time when he died, because his left leg was broken. The X-ray and the CT scan now can tell it happened when the time when he died. So maybe they hit his bone so he shouldn't run away. They put him down on his knees and turned his head back. They cut his throat from ear to ear, very deep to his bones. And of course he died in 1 minute or something, because the lack of so much blood.
So far, so damning. By examining the victim's teeth, Pauline's team discovered that he suffered from malnutrition as a child, but at death he was perfectly healthy. Through the latest technology, counting the lines in the formation of the bone, rather like counting the rings in a tree trunk, the team has calculated that Graubler man was 34 when he died. We are left with the undeniable fact that a healthy man in the prime of his life was murdered. Why? To solve this pagan murder mystery, I need to look at other evidence, starting with the time of death. In pagan times, marshland covered large swathes of northern Europe, from Ireland to Scandinavia. During the Iron Age, our pagan ancestors exploited this part of the landscape, just as they had exploited the forests. The Iron Age was the equivalent of a pagan industrial revolution. Man started to extract iron ore from the boglands to make weapons and tools. Peat was also extracted from the bogs as fuel to smelt this new resource. Everyone used the bog, benefited from it, lived almost on top of it. But the marshlands were also treacherous places, where carts and horses and human beings were swallowed whole by the hungry earth. So how did our ancestors get around the obvious problem of living and working in the most dangerous place in the landscape.
If we stop to think about it, many of us might be tempted to trace the origins of our modern motorways back to the Romans. And as the history books tell us, the Romans were supposed to be the first to build straight roads in Britain. But in fact, from the Stone Age onwards, hundreds of wooden trackways and roads were built, often over miles, across the treacherous bogs and marshlands of northern Europe.
The steward went into the bog. It seemed to him as though all the men in the world from sunrise to sunset had come to the bog. Into the bottom of the causeway, they kept putting a forest with its trunks and its roots.
So now, Richard, here we see 18 metres of the Iron Age 148 BC trackway. Now, the trackway ran for a kilometre in length. It ran in a northwest-southeast direction for a kilometre. The work that was involved, it had to be a great communal effort.
Noel Carberry is a guide at the Corlay Museum, which houses the longest and best-preserved wooden trackway in Europe.
They're basically of oak.
That's amazing, isn't it?
We'll just have a look up at the centre here.
There's a bit of a bump in the road there.
Yeah, and in this area, especially this part of Ireland, we carry on this ancient Celtic tradition of having holes in our roads. This is the original one here.
I mean, just looking at this, it really makes you wonder exactly how much timber was used to make the whole track.
Well, they have estimated that it would have taken up to 300 large, mature oak trees. Now, that's just for the planks, the timbers on the top part of the track itself. Then you have to think of the runners, the supporting timbers, maybe twice as much there. Also the pegs that were driven through to stabilise the timbers of the track. They've estimated they would have used up to 5,000.
So is it possible to see any cart ruts or anything like that on the surface to show what it was used for?
That's the strange thing about it. There's no signs of any marks, any wheel ruts on the timbers themselves. They're not sure if it was maybe just used for one ceremonial occasion or if it was, another theory is that it was maybe a symbol of a road to the afterlife.
Why would our pagan ancestors have invested such a huge amount of time, effort and natural resources to make a wooden road to nowhere and then apparently not use it? The answer to this and to our pagan murder mystery lies at the scene of the crime. The bog itself. The bog was a dangerous place, but it was also a place of mystery. It was a place that was neither earth nor water, but both. The mists and gases, as well as adding to its danger, gave it a mystical aura. Like everywhere else in the landscape, the bog had its spirits, but these were capricious spirits that needed appeasing. In the Danish wetlands, archaeologists found the remains of an ornate wagon. Torben Egberg thinks that this was put there deliberately to appease these spirits, because this was no ordinary wagon.
Things that makes it different from other wagons is the bronze mountings. They have an iron band on the wheels. At that time, you didn't have wagons of that kind for agricultural purpose. And here you can see how they made ornaments. They have used bronze and silver.
So it must have been very expensive.
You can call it a Rolls Royce.
And then they just put it in the bog.
Yeah. In the bog.
But why build the Rolls-Royce of wagons and then destroy it? A clue comes from an unlikely source, the Roman.